was a good one. That was a good one. Good afternoon. My name is Terry Cannon. I'm the executive director of the Baseball Reliquary, and on behalf of the board of directors and membership of the Reliquary, it is my pleasure to welcome you to the 18th annual Induction Day ceremony for the Shrine of the Eternals. Two more years till number 20. The bell ringing, which has commenced these festivities since 1999, is in tribute to perhaps the most famous fan in baseball history and the game's greatest percussionist, the late Hilda Chester. She is as much a part of Dodgers lore as Jackie, Pistol Pete, Pee-wee, the Duke of Flatbush, and of course that unforgettable Dodger mantra, "Wait till next year." Did you know that our beloved Hilda had a brief fling on the silver screen? Yes, indeed. The same woman who was once described as having been blessed with a voice that could peel the hide off an elephant's back was a big enough ballpark celebrity to have a small role in a 1943 MGM comedy, Whistling in Brooklyn, starring Red Skelton. Some of the scenes were shot in Ebbets Field, and Hilda Chester plays, what else, a baseball fan. When the press got wind of this, they had some fun with it, as you would expect. Writing in the Reading Daily Eagle, columnist Alice Hughes observed, "Beware Hollywood. Hilda Chester, the most famous rooter of our beloved Brooklyn Dodgers, is playing a bit in the new Red Skelton movie. So look out, Hedy Lamarr and Greer Garson." And New York Post columnist Jerry Mitchell dubbed Hilda the Scarlett O'Hara of Ebbets Field. But there was one movie star Hilda did not particularly like, and that was Lorraine Day, who just happened to be married to Hilda's absolute favorite Dodger, Leo DeRocher. Leo could do no wrong in Hilda's eyes, until, that is, he married Miss Day in January of 1947. How jealous was Hilda, you ask? So jealous that at the beginning of the 1947 season, she abruptly switched her allegiance to the New York Yankees. Of course, Hilda adamantly denied that the presence of Lorraine Day had anything to do with it. She told one inquiring reporter, and I quote, "Lorraine, that's Leo's headache." Of course, DeRocher would soon be managing the rival New York Giants, and Hilda and her cowbells would soon be back in their outfield perch at Ebbets Field. And now it is my pleasure to bring to the stage Jay Spears, who will perform his renditions of the national anthem and "Take Me Out to the Ball Game." Jay is a Los Angeles-based singer-songwriter who has released 3 albums and is the recipient of the 2014 ASCAP Plus Award, which honors writers for distinguished work in the fields of symphonic and concert music, jazz, and musical theater. At this time, I would ask the audience to please rise as Jay Spears performs our national anthem. Thank you.
Please be seated. My name is, as the gentleman said, my name is Jay Spears. I'm an LA native, but my dad was a career Air Force officer, and we traveled around and lived everywhere, so I never really developed any regional loyalties for baseball or anything. Until I, my dad retired, I got out of school, and I came back to live in LA. And became a starving actor and a wealthy waiter. And which meant that I would come home and go to bed at 2 and roll out of bed at 11 Pacific time, which was when what was going on every day? The Cubs were coming on WGN. So I would roll out of bed just in time to see the Cubs, and so I became a baseball fan that way. And everyone knows, this was back in the what I call the Ryne Sandberg era, with Ryne Sandberg and Leon Durham, and Ron Say was at third, and Sean Dunstan, and Larry Boa even, and Jody Davis, and all them. But no matter what happened at Wrigley Field, everyone knows what happened at the seventh inning in Wrigley Field. Who would you get to listen to? All right. I'm not sure he knew it this way, but here's how it goes. Katie Casey was baseball mad, had the fever and had it bad, just to root on her hometown crew every Sioux. Katie Blue. On a Saturday, her young beau asked to see if she'd like to go to see a show, but young Kate said no. I'll tell you what you can do. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I ever get back. Let me root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame, 'cause it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game. Katie Casey saw all the games, knew the players by their first names, told the umpire he was wrong all along, good and strong. When the score was just 2-2, Katie Casey knew what to do. Just to cheer up the boys, she knew, she made the crowd sing this song. Everyone? Take me out to the lovely. Root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. But it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game. One more time. But it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the
Thank you, Jay. Before the keynote address and the induction of our Shrine of the Eternals class of 2016, it is my pleasure to introduce the recipients of 2 awards presented annually by the Baseball Reliquary. Leading off, we have the Hilda Award, established in 2001 in memory of Hilda Chester, and created to recognize distinguished service to the game by a baseball fan. As you know, we often refer to the Hilda as the Reliquarian's equivalent of the Oscar or the Emmy. It acknowledges our royalty, it symbolizes the best aspects of fandom, and it celebrates the myriad ways in which we exhibit our love affair with the national pastime. I know we have at least one former Hilda recipient here this afternoon, and that's Emma Maya working the back table. Emma. Emma received the Hilda in 2013, and the good vibes are still going on. She just threw out the first pitch the other day at Dodger Stadium. As the result of winning a trivia contest, and I'm urging anybody here, if you're ever pitted in a trivia contest against Hilda, against Emma, and it's about the Dodgers, just turn around and walk out of the room.
There's another Hilda winner here.
Okay. Oh, that's right. That's right. Arnold Hano, 2012. And Arnold? You're going to be seeing a lot more of Arnold later, so that's right, 2012. And I don't know if there's no other Hilda recipients. Bob Colleary comes in every now and then. He's the Hilda recipient that has Bill Veeck's old wooden leg. Usually you know when he comes in, when he's the guy carrying a wooden leg. The 2016 Hilda recipient has a very special personal meaning to me due to his connection to Detroit, which is where I was born, and as some of you know, I have been a lifelong Tigers fan. I think the best way to describe Tom Derry would be a living folk hero. He is founder of the Navin Field Grounds Crew, an all-volunteer group which between 2010 and 2016 preserved and maintained the historic Tiger Stadium baseball diamond in Detroit, transforming a demolished local landmark neglected by the city into a baseball mecca. Originally known as Navin Field, the site was later renamed Briggs Stadium and finally Tiger Stadium. When Tom Derry and his crew arrived with their mowers and their rakes, they found a trash-strewn field with weeds that were 6 and 8 feet tall, and through their hard work, they turned a trash dump into a field of dreams. In fact, for the last 6 years, Derry and his crew have tended to the 9-acre field at the intersection of Michigan and Trumbull, where baseball has been played for more than a century. Even amid threats early on of arrest for trespassing on the city-owned property. The same field where Babe Ruth hit his 700th home run in 1934, where Denny McLain won his 30th game in 1968, where Kirk Gibson's dramatic home run capped the 1984 World Series, became a pilgrimage for thousands of baseball fans from all across the nation. The same field that witnessed the exploits of Motor City baseball legends such as Ty Cobb, Hank Greenberg, Al Kaline, Willie Horton, Hal Newhouser, Dizzy Trout, Mickey Lolich, and Mark the Bird Fidrich has, since 2010, been home to Little League and pickup games of all kinds, as well as a site for scattering the ashes of loved ones and for wedding ceremonies. In fact, Derry married his wife, Sarah, who was a Navin Field grounds crew member at home plate in August 2014. Writing about the work of the Navin Field grounds crew for Rolling Stone in 2014, Dan Epstein commented, quote, "Their efforts testify to the deep emotional connection that so many Detroiters still feel to this spot. It's hard to imagine the sleek and corporate Comerica Park ever engendering a similar degree of affection. And by clearing away the weeds, the garbage, and the rubble, the NFGC has enabled the ghosts and vibrations of the now vanished ballpark to return," end quote. In recent months, the Detroit Police Athletic League has taken over the site, And while there has been some controversy surrounding their plans, they have indicated that the historic playing field will be maintained for youth baseball. The grass, however, that was so lovingly maintained by Tom and his volunteers is in the process of being replaced with artificial turf. The grassroots urban renewal project that Tom Derry founded has not gone unnoticed. The Navin Field grounds crew was recently honored at home plate with the Spirit of Detroit Award, one of the highest civic recognitions in Detroit. They are also the subject of an outstanding documentary called Stealing Home, which was recently nominated for an Emmy Award by the Michigan chapter of the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences. Now, the Reliquary has purchased copies of the DVD, and we are making them available for you to purchase today at our table in the back. And I can assure all Reliquarians here today, no matter which team you root for, or whether or not you ever set foot in Tiger Stadium, this documentary on Tom Derry's efforts to transform a forgotten ballpark into a sanctuary will bring a tear to the eyes of even the most unsentimental baseball fan. And did I mention that the amazing Mr. Derry also has a unique wintertime obsession? A huge Babe Ruth aficionado, he has for 29 consecutive years hosted a birthday party for the Bambino on the first Saturday in February. In his inaugural bash for the Babe in 1988, a few of Derry's friends showed up. In the ensuing years, the event has become a major happening with 1,000 Ruthian rooters from all over the country packed into Nemo's Bar in Detroit's Corktown for this year's celebration. Derry spends 2 weeks prepping for the ultimate hot stove league party, decorating every inch of the bar from floor to ceiling with thousands of Ruth pictures, posters, and items of memorabilia. 1,000 balloons line the ceiling with plenty of hot dogs and beer flowing all night, just the way the Babe would want to be remembered. Tom Derry is a postal worker who lives in Redford Township, Michigan. We are delighted that he is here today, along with his wife, Sarah, to personally accept this honor. As we unveil the 2016 Hilda Award, please welcome a man whose dedication to baseball, as exhibited through his various labors of love, has earned him our gratitude, Tom Derry.
Yeah, so Terry was talking about my wintertime obsession. When I was 24 years old, I used to hang out at a little bar on Grand River Avenue in Detroit, and they had an old jukebox with a happy birthday song on it, and the owner of the bar, an older lady named Ethel Thompson, just hated the song, so I played it all the time just to annoy her. And she'd always say, well, whose damn birthday is it now? And so I started bringing in photographs of old-time ball players on their birthdays, and I'd play the birthday song, and then I'd take out the framed photo and set it on the bar, and the people at the bar got a kick out of it, so I just kept it going. And then November of 87, I started thinking about birthdays that were coming up in December and January. I'm thinking, oh yeah, we got Johnny Bench coming up on the 7th, and then we got Al Kaline and Ty Cobb in December, Hank Greenberg January 1st, and then we got Jackie Robinson and Hank Aaron on the 5th of February and February 6th, and I thought, wow, February 6th. Babe Ruth, I can't just bring a photo. That calls for a party, because he just loved beer and hot dogs and life. And so it just seemed like a good theme for a party. And my friends told me it was a ridiculous idea, and I didn't think anyone would show up. But anyways, we had a great time. Yeah, there were about 12 of us there that first year, and we had a blast, and I just kept it going all these years. And And eventually Babe Ruth's family heard about it and they started showing up. And so that kind of ties in with this weekend because Babe Ruth's family invited Sarah and I yesterday. We were in New Hampshire to celebrate the 100th birthday of Babe Ruth's daughter, Julia Ruth Stevens. She turned 100 yesterday. So that's where we were yesterday. So we just flew from Boston this morning, and now we're here, and so like we're a couple of jet setters or something. But it's been a crazy weekend. But it, you know, to be invited to that party and then to hear, you know, to be honored with the Hilda Award, it's just been a crazy weekend, and we're just thrilled to be here. So I was familiar with Hilda Chester. I know she was a big Dodger fan, and she'd go in the park and ring her bell and bring her signs. And I think it's so cool what the Baseball Reliquary has done. And I'm just proud that they recognize the efforts of our grounds crew. And I'm just pleased to be here, and to, you know, be here with Arnold Hano, and you know, at the same time the Reliquary is honoring Don Newcomb and Bo Jackson. It's just a thrill to be here. So Sarah and I are just so thrilled to be here. But it's, as far as the Navin Field grounds crew, it may have never have happened without Tiger broadcaster Hall of Famer Ernie Harwell. He passed away in early May of 2010. And like many fans, I went to Comerica Park to pay my respects to Ernie. And then I came home later that day and I caught a little story on the news about how some fans didn't want to go to Comerica Park to remember him. Their way to remember him was to go onto the old field at Michigan and Trumbull and play catch. And so that really touched my heart. I thought that was a great story. And I thought, I didn't know that you could get out there. I didn't know the field was open. So I went down a few days later on Mother's Day of 2010 with Sarah and some of our friends. And we just went down there just to be able to take some swings, to play catch, you know, to play on the same field that so many of the greatest players ever have played on. Over 200 Hall of Famers, you know, played on that field. It was just a thrill to be there. But once we started playing, I wasn't that excited because I saw the condition of the field, how tall the grass was, the weeds everywhere. You could barely make out the dirt infield where it was. There were so many weeds. The pitcher's mound, everything, baselines, nothing but weeds, garbage everywhere. So I figured, well, I got a riding mower and I can cut the grass. So I figured I'd go home and call my friends and see if anyone was interested. So I did. I went home and called my friends, and we came back a few days later and we had our first cleanup at the ball field. It was the 12th of May, 2010. And the city wasn't happy that they were there. An official from the city came out and told us we weren't welcome there, but we weren't leaving, we stayed. We continued to work. A few minutes later, the police showed up, but they left us alone, they left. But so that was our first day at the field, and so we continued to come back every week. And the city continued to threaten us with arrest, but we kept coming back. And eventually, it took a while, but they finally left us alone. And we were just happy. We knew the city didn't have the resources to maintain the park, and we did it because we felt it was the right thing to do. And when I was out there, I remember the first time I was on my riding mower, you know, out there in left field, and I thought, wow, this is where, you know, I used to sit in the left field grandstands, and there'd be number 23 right in front of me, Willie Horton, out there in left field. And I thought about the history going back even decades earlier. I'm thinking that's the same spot where the Tiger fans pelted Joe Medwick with garbage in the 1934 World Series after he slid hard into Tiger third baseman Marv Owen. So all that history, it lives on there. And you know, and I'd cut the grass in center field and think, wow, Tris Speaker played here. And I'd go out in right field, Babe Ruth played here, and Al Kaline. It's just, there's just so much history there on that field. And what happened was the people then in that neighborhood, it became their park. Obviously, we were concerned with preserving the historic dimensions of the field, but we also wanted it to be a park that everyone could enjoy. And that's what we had for 6 years. We had an open park accessible to everyone. Even if people didn't want to play baseball, they had picnics, they had parties, they could walk their dogs, fly a kite. And actually, we were happy people walked their dogs, because we had a problem there with the Canadian geese pooping all over the field, and it got to be terrible. We tried all kinds of things to get rid of them, and I was even putting up these fake owls in the outfield, hoping it would scare them away. That did not work, but the dogs did, and it was great because the people had a place where they could run with their dogs, and we turned that field. We really did a great job. We're not professional groundskeepers. We didn't have a sponsor. We paid for everything ourselves. And one time we had a groundskeeper from Comerica Park come out and tell us that our dirt infield looked professional. And we did a great job. We had no watering system. We just relied on Mother Nature. And the field really looked good. And we were hosting Little League games, adult fast pitch games, vintage baseball, the way it was played in the 1860s. We had many games over the last several years there at Michigan and Trumbull. It was a grass baseball field from 1896 up until about 10 days ago. The configurations now are the Navin Field configurations. The park opened the same day as Fenway Park in Boston on the 20th of April, 1912. So the dimensions were the same, the history is all still there. And we did everything we could to preserve it. And before that, it was Bennett Park. It was a wooden structure, and home plate was actually at the corner of Michigan and Trumbull. So that's why when you hear people say Michigan and Trumbull, it's because many years ago, home plate was there. But since 1912, the configuration was the same. And that site just means so much to so many people. On dozens of occasions, we've witnessed people scattering the ashes of their loved ones there. And that's just when we're down there. So I have no doubt in the last 5 years, 6 years, that probably 200 people or more have had their ashes scattered there. So the site means that much to so many people, and at least 5 couples have been married there, including Sarah and I 2 years ago. So to many people, it's sacred ground. We just enjoyed it so much, and we've had several former Tigers come out to visit the field. We've had like 1968 world champions, Denny McLean come out and Mickey Lolich. And Mickey Lolich came out and he came out to watch his grandson playing a Little League game. And he had a great time. And, some couple of 1984 Tigers have also come out, Lou Whitaker and Dave Rosma. And another former Tiger who was just an all-around good utility man. He could play just about every position. His name is John Walkenfuss. Not a famous Tiger, but I don't think I ever saw a better hit and run man than John Walkenfuss. I mean, every time he'd just deliver a base hit into right field, and he's a right-handed hitter, and he was just, he could catch, he could play first base, outfield, third base. But he became a huge supporter of ours, and he actually drove up from Delaware a couple years ago just to play baseball with us on that field, to play ball with us and his fans. So we've gotten a lot of support from former Tigers. Not so much from the city, but that changed this year. They did recognize us, as Terry mentioned. They gave us a Spirit of Detroit Award. Eventually they recognized our efforts. We were very disappointed to hear that. We're not anti-development. We're not anti-PAL, the Police Athletic League, who got control of the site. But we really did think the historic park like this, the grass should have been preserved. Not only that, we had a 9-acre green space in the heart of historic Corktown. And the people in the neighborhood really loved being able to go out there, and that's all going to change now. The access is going to be gone. We think it's great that kids will continue to play baseball there. But as far as our grounds crew, we're going to move on to new projects. We weren't just passionate about Michigan and Trumbull and baseball. I mean, we're passionate about improving the city, and we love Detroit. And some of our grounds crew members live in Detroit, and some don't. But Detroit lives in all of us, and we're going to continue on. We've already cut the grass at Clark Park this last week in southwest Detroit, and we're going to be cleaning up and fixing up other baseball diamonds as well. Many people have said you should move on to maybe try Hamtramck Stadium. That was an old Negro League park, and it's one of only a few left in the nation that's still standing. And that one needs a lot of work, and that may be that may be a future project for us. And that's what I'm wearing, my Detroit Stars jersey here, like the great Turkey Stearns wore back in the 20s and that. So that could be our next project, I'm not sure. And actually, I wore this jersey when I got married to Sarah at home plate, so 2 years ago. So. But yeah, but it's been the people I've met from that grounds crew are the greatest people. These volunteers are amazing. Some of them drive hours each way just to come to that field every weekend, year after year, driving hundreds of miles to pick up garbage, to rake the infield, to pull weeds, and it's just the most dedicated group. And while it's sad that they tore out the field, these people that I've met over the last 6 years mean so much more to me than the park ever did. And I'm just honored to have made so many friends over the last 6 years. And we're going to move on, and we're going to continue to do what we can to work on improving the city, and to do what we can to fix up ballparks in Detroit. And I'm honored to be here today to receive the Hilda Award. And thank you.
Pretty good choice for the Hilda Award this year, wouldn't you say? Our second award was established in 2002 to recognize individuals for their commitment to the preservation of baseball history. The Tony Salen Memorial Award is named in honor of the baseball historian, author, and reliquarian who passed away in 2001 at age 49 and whose research collection is now housed at the Institute for Baseball Studies at Whittier College. From the time he was 8 years old, Tony was referred to as Mr. Baseball by family and friends, whom he regularly astounded with his exhaustive knowledge of facts and trivia related to old-time ballplayers. Over the years, this preoccupation blossomed into a passion for the study and research of unsung players and forgotten aspects of baseball history, which he felt were important to document and keep alive for future generations. As has been the case for each year since the award's inception, Tony Salen's brother, Doug, has driven down from San Francisco to Pasadena to be here for the awards presentation. And today, Doug is joined by his fellow San Franciscans, Jack Maurer and Kim Shuck. Would you stand? As always, we thank Doug and his friends for their annual road trip and for taking part in our ongoing celebration of Tony Salen's memory. The 2016 Salen Award honoree, Neftali Williams, is a photojournalist, writer, scholar, and recent graduate from the University of Southern California's Master of Public Diplomacy program. His area of expertise is sports diplomacy, with a specific emphasis in using skateboarding as a tool for cultural diplomacy. In addition, Williams is bringing a new level of understanding to racial dynamics in America as the research and development director for the African American Experience in Major League Baseball Oral History Project. Launched in 2014 by Dr. Daniel T. Durbin, director of the Annenberg Institute of Sports, Media, and Society at the University of Southern California, the African American Experience Project was established to collect and preserve interviews with every living African American baseball player from the first 25 years after Major League Baseball's racial integration, from 1947 to 1971, comprising well over 100 subjects, many of whose personal histories remain largely undocumented. The primary purpose of this ambitious undertaking is to create a comprehensive digital library of oral histories for future generations of researchers and historians. Since work began on the project in 2014, Williams has conducted over 25 interviews, and his curiosity, enthusiasm, and youthful perspective, he is often half a century younger than his subjects, have won over many of the players, allowing them to open up and share stories they have never told before. For Williams, each player helps form a living bridge to an important era in Black history with contributions that span beyond baseball. As we unveil the 2016 Tony Salen Memorial Award, please join me in welcoming its recipient, Neftali Williams.
Thank you, everyone. First, I just want to thank the Baseball Reliquary for letting me be even honored here. The Tony Salen Award is an amazing thing to get, and I am a little nervous now, so I'm going to try to calm down. But I'll treat it like we're interviewing our subjects. So one of the best things about the project is it does just do that. It creates bridges over gaps between generations. The way that baseball is looked at by some of the younger generation and the older generation is that it's something that maybe their parents did or their uncle did, and there's this missing space that tells the history of African Americans in the game. And also say to make sure to acknowledge African Americans and other minority players in the game as well, because during that time when they were playing, if you weren't white, you were looked at as Black, and that's for the Dominican players, the Cuban players. And having the ability to tell the stories of all those players and their lives together, what it was like on the road, how baseball has changed, and be able to present a little bit of the story of how baseball actually changed the fabric of this country. Before, you know, at the time that they started, you know, they played during the civil rights movements, they played before those times occurred. Just stories of them being on the bus and being told that, well, we don't serve niggers here. And that was for one of the Dominican players. And he went in there saying, like, wait a minute, I don't understand. I thought I wasn't the same. So having those stories between Dominican players, the Cuban players, the African American players, and realizing that at that point in time and in history, we're all united, that's something that I look forward to sharing with everyone, because there are a lot of things that are going on in America right now. And something just as simple and as fun as baseball was used to bring us all together. I hope we get to come back to that space again. So, again, I'm just really, really honored to be here and to receive this award. And if any of you know any players that stories haven't been told, please reach out to us at the Institute for Sports Media and Society. And thank you very much.
And I know that a few of the short excerpts from Neftali's work have been posted online. So you can see, in fact, we just linked to one on our Facebook page the other day. And with Manny Mota, I know there's a brief excerpt with Manny Mota and Dusty Baker. So you can get a taste of the interviews. And of course, the ones that will eventually be available through USC will be the longer versions. Always one of the most eagerly anticipated speeches at the Shrine of the Eternals Induction Day is the keynote address, which this year will be delivered by Michael Fallon, a writer based in the Twin Cities of Minnesota. Since 1997, he has published hundreds of reviews, feature articles, essays, and profiles on all sorts of subjects, including art, Southern California, baseball, music, food, American social and cultural history, and more. He is the author of the book Dodgerland, Decadent Los Angeles and the 1977-78 Dodgers, and Creating the Future, Art and Los Angeles in the 1970s. As you can tell from his book titles, Michael's research interests, with their emphasis on baseball and art, are very much in alignment with the founding fathers and mothers of the Baseball Reliquary. This is a homecoming of sorts for Michael Fallon, as he spent his formative years in Pasadena playing Little League Baseball just a few miles from here at Victory Park in East Pasadena, where in the 1970s, as a Dodger fan, he dreamed of becoming the next Steve Garvey. He studied art at UC Berkeley and in the graduate art program at Cal State Fullerton, and completed a master's degree in arts management at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, where he spearheaded a comprehensive study of the nation's aging artists. Now, I do want to mention that this afternoon's keynote address marks the beginning of a week-long series of speaking engagements in Pasadena for Michael. So those of you who live in the area will have the opportunity to engage with him in smaller and more informal settings. This Wednesday, July 20th at 7 o'clock p.m., Michael will discuss and sign copies of his book, Creating the Future, Art in Los Angeles in the 1970s, at the wonderful Century Bookshop on Green Street in Pasadena. And then Michael will conclude his mini tour with a book signing and discussion for Dodgerland, Decadent Los Angeles and the 1977-78 Dodgers, next Saturday, July 23rd at 2 o'clock p.m. at the Allendale Branch Library in Pasadena, where I am gainfully employed. And incidentally, those of you who came into the library today through the north entrance no doubt saw the display based on Michael's Dodgerland book, which was curated by the Baseball Reliquary and which will be on view through the end of this month. Dodgerland is a wonderfully researched political and cultural history of Los Angeles during the decade of the 1970s, incorporating into its narrative the highs and lows of those great Dodger teams of 1977 and 78. But for today, we are delighted to have him all to ourselves. So please welcome to the lectern to deliver the Shrine of the Eternals 2016 keynote address, Michael Fallon.
Good afternoon. I'm very honored to be here today, of course. I'd like to thank the Baseball Reliquary and Terry Cannon for extending an invitation to speak to you. It's a little better. I'd also like to commend this year's inductees to the Shrine of Eternals, Arthur Hano, Bo Jackson, and Don Newcomb. None of us would really be here without what you guys have done and what you've done for baseball and for the wider culture of our country. So I'd like to commend you. Finally, I offer my congratulations to Tom Derry and Neftali Williams, winners of the 2016 Hilda Award and the Tony Salen Memorial Award, respectively. It's a tribute to your accomplishments that even out in flyover country where I now live, I'd heard of your efforts. And I'd met people who knew of your efforts, and you're truly an inspiration to me, and your accomplishments are amazing. So thank you. One other thing, I'm adding off the cuff. I love the performance by Jay earlier, and in particular, I love the fact that he's saying, I don't know if they do this regularly at the Reliquary, I've only been to one of these events, but saying the verses of the original verses of Take Me Out to the Ball Game, which are verses that me and my daughter have learned. I have a six-year-old daughter who I'm trying to train to be a baseball fan. And the fact that they sing about Katie Casey, she loves that, and she wonders, that's the best part of the song. Why don't they sing it at the baseball games? And I say, I know, but people just don't understand. And she says, oh, well, okay. So thanks for doing that. That was great. In fact, singing two verses was wonderful. So you heard about me. I sound really great. But, you know, I'm a new baseball book author. This is my first real stab at writing about baseball. I wrote a few things for Sabre's baseball biography project before this. One of the things I have enjoyed as a new baseball book author is speaking to others about the sport and about my experiences with it. But one of the things I've also learned over the past few months is my take on baseball is sometimes not the norm. Though I enjoy the game's statistics and shared memories of outstanding games and player performances, what I tend to fixate more on is how these stats and feats fit into the culture. My interest in the wider meaning of baseball comes likely because of my own personal path as a follower of the sport. In this talk, I'll try to explain a little bit about what I mean by this. To start with, I should offer you a bit of background. As Terry mentioned, for 6 years or so during the 1970s, my family, my mom, dad, and two younger brothers, lived not far from here, about 4.6 miles, according to Google, in a little post-war rambler on Santa Paula Avenue and the east side of Pasadena. About 1.3 miles from my home was my grade school, located on Orange Grove Avenue. It was officially called the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary School. I believe it's still there. But we all refer to it as kids as the Assumption of the BVM, which I hope isn't some kind of mortal sin. I'm really hopeful. Across the street from the school is a park called Victory Park, which is where I first learned to play baseball in the East Pasadena Little League, which I believe is no longer exists. I think it folded into a couple other leagues, in case you're wondering. But that was where I learned how to play baseball. And it was very reminiscent, if you've seen it recently, seen Bad News Bears. My perfect memories of what Little League was like. I mentioned these places and distances to plot a map for you of my world about age 8 or so to about age 11 or 12. These are the years that are covered in my baseball book. This physical topography, which contained driveway wiffle ball games of baseball with neighborhood kids, Little League games I played on the Johnson Products team in East Pasadena Little League, games of scrub baseball at Assumption, which we used to call workups. Anybody else play this game, workups? Talk to me after, because I want to review the rules. I don't remember the rules, but that's what we always used to play at school. All the times I saw baseball games on TV and at the ballpark with my dad, and all the faux baseball games that I would play in my head while I was walking around Pasadena to school or riding my bike. This is where I became aware of the geography of baseball. I use the term geography purposefully. For baseball, for me as a kid, was a way of navigating through space, of situating myself in a confusing world and protecting myself from what made me anxious. Things like bullies, new experiences, camping trips, kids on the bus, kids from neighboring other unknown neighborhoods, priests and nuns, and of course, in those years, increasingly girls. Do you remember the interactive map that the New York Times posted a few years ago? The one that plotted out county by county what the influence of various baseball teams across the United States. You probably can't see this, but you can Google it by typing in New York Times and map of baseball nation. I sort of envision my baseball landscape being just like this, except the tiny geographical units are not the individual counties that they map on this map, but are millions and millions of individual fans across the country, each living within their own individual baseball geography. In the geography of baseball, of course, each nation has its own origin story. That is, I imagine most of you, if prompted, could situate the origins of your love and dedication to your own baseball team with your own, within your own specific topographical map of moments and memories and associations. And of course, each of our nations has its own special lineup of heroes. These are the gladiators from our team that fight for us against the treacherous, unjust world. In my case, I was fortunate that in 1974, just as my 8-year-old anxiety was mounting in the aftermath of a harrowing bullying incident and a resulting change of schools, there arrived on the Dodgers a fresh batch of noble heroes, people like Steve Garvey, Ron Say, Dave Lopes, Bill Buckner, and later Dusty Baker, Doug Rao, Bill Russell, Steve Yeager, Tom Pashorek, and later Reggie Smith, and so on. It was these men, in many ways, who carried me safely into my high school years. The geography of baseball also helped me understand something important at an early age. I learned that the baseball nationality you choose could be an advantage, or it could bring you some trouble. Some 95% of the kids that I knew at school and in Little League and in Cub Scouts were, and so on, were Dodger fans. They were just that dominant of a team in those years. However, I did meet enough fans of other teams, like the Angels or the Yankees or Giants, Reds, Padres, etc., to know something about rivalry and antipathy. The worst in those years, of course, were the Cincinnati Reds. Between 1970 and 1976, the team from Cincinnati finished in first place 5 times out of 7 seasons, and my team, the Dodgers, finished right behind in second place in each of those 5 seasons. It was quite embittering. Now, some would argue that this rivalry stuff is part of the fun of baseball and of sports in general. But at the same time, we've all seen how rivalry can be just a small step away from the social exclusion that often emerges out of group identity. Think of the bigger stakes, geographical clashes between the British nation and the European Union, for instance. I myself have, as I would guess many of us have, sometimes identified too closely with my baseball nation. This is especially true in times of anxiety or during which I forget my sense of sporting fun and fall into a kind of mad antipathy for those other guys. I have even allowed my feelings of being wronged by a team or a player lead me to feel something approximating hatred. Not to mention any names, but Reggie Jackson. This, of course, leads to some bigger questions. Why exactly do we create these nations, baseball nations, for ourselves? What is the human impulse behind this kind of group identification? And in this divided, sometimes divisive world, is this a completely healthy or productive thing for us to do? Rather than stumble toward an answer to these questions, though, I'd like to relate here a story that is at the crux of both my personal baseball geography and my path to becoming a baseball writer. My grandfather, Thomas Fallon, is a character in Dodgerland. And the story he once told me years ago about a specific time and place in his life had such an impact in me that, though I didn't realize it at the time, was so profound that it informs my identity even now. Born into coal country in eastern Pennsylvania in 1920 to an extended Irish coal mining family, Tom Fallon became an orphan in 1929 after the death of his mother. Since his father could not care for the 5 children, Tom was placed in a Catholic orphanage located in downtown Philadelphia. Here he quickly became unhappy. In addition to now being motherless, Tom had also been taken away from the rest of his siblings, 2 younger brothers and 2 younger sisters, one of whom was less than 2 years old. Additionally, with Tom, the nuns at his orphanage were strict and somewhat inhumane. My grandfather told stories to me of being beaten so often for being left-handed and for other such crimes that, after teaching himself how to write with both hands, he vowed he would never have anything to do with nuns or churches again. In 1938, when my grandfather turned 18 and was released from the orphanage, he fled from Pennsylvania and never returned. He went to live with some relatives in New York, probably one of many aunts or cousins or something. The actual place is lost to history. And he found some sort of work, maybe as a stock boy or a store clerk or something. The plan was for him to wait and get established and as his own siblings moved to New York themselves and they could all reconnect. My grandfather worked hard. He saved what money he could, and he waited for the grim memories of his childhood to fade. Now, I'm not looking for sympathy on behalf of Tom Fallon. You should know that when I knew him in later years, he was the most loving, caring, curious, interested person that you would ever meet, and was widely beloved by everybody in the family. Rather, I mention his tough childhood to posit the idea that my grandfather, lost and living in Brooklyn at age 18, was ripe to fall into the geography of baseball. And so that's exactly what he did. In 1938, my grandfather became a Brooklyn Dodgers fan. And now, this was an odd and unlikely choice for several reasons. First of all, Tom Fallon was not a Brooklyn native, so he really didn't have any associations with the place or the people. Additionally, the Dodgers in those years were not only the perennial doormat of the National League, but they were also something of a joke. They were known for bumbling in very epic ways. Their management was known for its profligacy. And they were even known, the players were known for being sort of addicted to gambling. But my grandfather fell into their orbit nonetheless, mostly and curiously because of one player. My favorite player is a bit notorious today, he told me in the 1970s, probably after I had explained to him the virtues of my own baseball hero, Steve Garvey. He was a natural leader. You could see that even then. And a great shortstop. He had great hands. You could get to almost any ball hit to him. He paused just long enough for me to ask, well, who is it? It was Leo DeRocher, he said. Now, as it happens, this was a really impressively prescient choice of a favorite baseball player. 1938, DeRocher was a new and reluctant Brooklynite. You know, having just come from the world champion Cardinals, and earlier having played with the Yankees of Ruth and Garrick and Lazeri and all the rest, DeRocher said he had dropped through a trapdoor onto a team that would finish seventh place in the National League that year. My grandfather, though, saw something in the aging shortstop, who played well enough in the first half of that season to be named to the league's All-Star team. In 1939, DeRocher began to change his mind about Brooklyn and the Dodgers after he was named player manager and led them to an 84-69 third place finish. And by 1941, DeRocher's Dodgers appeared in their first World Series in 21 years. For my grandfather, DeRocher and the Dodgers came at just the right time. They became his baseball nation as he recovered from life in the orphanage, met his future wife, and then moved to Albany, New York, became a shopkeeper who supported his alcoholic father during stints of brief sobriety, joined the Albany Police Department, and then eventually, and inexplicably to the rest of his siblings, grew restless and moved his family to the land of milk and golden honey, Southern California, in the 1950s. Looking back, it would have been easy for my grandfather to give up at some point in his life and to lose complete faith. He could have turned to anger and resentment over the lot that life had dealt him at an early age. He could have taken the one small solace he had found in the early stages of his liberated adult life, his membership in the Dodger Nation, and turned that into a defensive shield against a harsh world. But instead, he was always optimistic and somehow open to what the world had to offer. He preferred to remain a cheerful baseball fan and to pass on the love of the game to others. When I knew him, he was a fan of the entire sport, and particularly of its history. I trace the origins of my own love for the history and meaning of baseball to the time that he loaned me, when I was 12 years old, one of his favorite books, Lawrence Ritter's The Glory of Their Times. One additional twist of fate was the fact that just 4 years after my grandfather moved west, the Dodgers shifted its geography to locate itself just a freeway drive away down in Los Angeles. Still, even if his team hadn't moved west, another team such as the Athletics or Senators had instead, and even if all his grandchildren had become, heaven forbid, Giants fans or Yankees fans or whatever, it didn't really matter. My grandfather remained ever charitable to any member of the baseball continent, even as he never wavered in allegiance to his own baseball nation. In 2010, almost 20 years after Tom Fallon had passed away, I lost a job due to the recession. And suddenly I was at home alone with a 3-month-old child to care for, and without really thinking about it, I began writing about my grandfather. When it became clear sometime over the next few years that the manuscript I was working on was actually going to become a book, and that the book was also about baseball and other things, I found myself thinking about my relationship to the wider continent of baseball. If I was going to do the rest of the work necessary for the manuscript to see the light of day, I thought, would I really want to keep holding on to the resentments and antipathies that I seem to feel were such an important part of being a baseball fan? In time, I decided it didn't make sense to do so if I was going to truly tell my grandfather's story. Sometime around 2012, then, I pushed myself to break out of my nationalistic baseball patterns. I joined Sabre and attended my first convention. A little while later, I joined the Baseball Reliquary and started contemplating the eternal worth of players outside of my baseball geography, like Lefty O'Doul and Rusty Staub and Louis Tiant and so on. I started playing fantasy baseball here and there and secretly and enjoyed sincerely rooting for players on just about every team in the league. I joined several passionate Facebook baseball groups. I see some of the people on those groups here, where I argued and defended my team and learned not to get too worked up whenever someone told me how much they hated Tom Lasorda and anything to do with Dodger Blue. I met and became friends with people like the author Dan Epstein, the artist Greg Josefsky, here earlier, the writer Jeff Pullman, the documentary filmmaker John Leonidakis, and none of these people were even remotely members of my baseball nation, but it turned out that they were members of the nation of truly great people. In time, under the influence of this new openness, I started feeling calmer, more accepting and at ease. In time, I began to understand what drove my grandfather. And in time, I also had two other important realizations. First off, I realized that stuck as we are, each of us, with our own baseball nationalities, and trapped as we are within our own baseball geographies, we still exist in a much larger, very flourishing ecosystem of disparate and diverse nations. Some of these nations, sure, will be rivals to us. A few maybe even declare themselves to be our enemies, but this is all fine, because in the bigger picture, all baseball nations are compatriots. All the different baseball geographies, as unique from each other as they may be, still are fundamentally bound together by the larger truth that we're more alike than we are different. I only wish the Brexit folk and anyone else who preaches the gospel of exclusion and separation could learn what the nations of baseball have taught me over the past few years. Additionally, I realized a completely unexpected thing in the process of researching and writing this book and preparing for its publication. That is, the more I learned about him, the more I understood how he prepared to play the game despite what he had to deal with, and the more I realized the uniqueness of his heartbreaking, at least to me, accomplishments, the more I actually came to admire Reggie Jackson. Yeah, I said it, and I know... As much as I know that if Tommy Lasorda here, I'd have to endure 1,000 obscenities for saying this, I can't help it. I learned, strangely, that this guy that I hated from the age of 11 years old, that had broken my heart, through the process of introspection, I actually came to admire Reggie Jackson. So in the end, I just have to say that I wish everyone would know what I now do, that baseball connects us in the midst of our differences, that our differences are really nothing in comparison to how strongly our baseball selves and our human selves are similar. It only took 6 years and the publication of a fairly sizable book for me to learn this, but for this, I will be eternally grateful. And I'm really grateful for your attention. Thank you so much, and thank you for having me.
Thank you, Michael. And now it is time to commence with the induction of our 2016 electees to the Shrine of the Eternals and the unveiling and presentation of the inductee plaques. The three individuals we honor today were elected by the membership of the Baseball Reliquary in voting conducted in April, and they received the highest number of votes from a ballot consisting of 50 candidates. Two identical plaques have been assembled in honor of each inductee, one which is presented to the inductee, and one which becomes part of the permanent collection of the Baseball Reliquary and is used for exhibition purposes. I would also like to acknowledge the presence of William Scaff. Bill, can you stand? He's a former Pasadena resident, artist, and longtime reliquarian who way back in 1999 designed the acrylic plaques we present annually to our inductees. Bill also designed both the Hilda and the Tony Salen Memorial Awards. Our first inductee, Don Newcomb, was elected to the Shrine of the Eternals in his first year on the ballot, a feat that is rarely accomplished, yet happened twice this year. Unfortunately, due to a previous commitment, Mr. Newcomb is unable to attend today's ceremony. But the man that he has asked to pinch hit for him, to both introduce and to accept the induction on his behalf, is more than capable of handling such an assignment. Mark Langille is well known to many reliquarians as having one of the best jobs in baseball, the team historian of the Los Angeles Dodgers. A member of the Dodgers front office since 1994, Mark previously covered the ball club as a Pasadena Star News beat reporter from 1989. Sorry about that, Mark. 1989 to 1993. A graduate of Cal State Northridge, Mark has also shared his encyclopedic knowledge of the boys in blue through his authorship of 5 books about the Dodgers, including Game of My Life and Dodger Stadium. As we unveil Don Newcomb's induction plaque and welcome him to the Shrine of the Eternals, please give a warm round of applause to Mark Langille.
Well, first of all, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you very much, Terry. And Terry, I'd like to, before I talk about Don, I'd like to thank you for an added bonus that I wasn't expecting today, because I was looking ahead, and all of a sudden I heard Terry say the phrase, and the most anticipated speech of the day, and I was kind of flustered. I mean, I've known Terry for a long time, and I really didn't expect that. And then I looked at the program and realized it wasn't yet my turn. But it is a pleasure to be here, and it's an honor to represent Don Newcomb, and one of the gentlemen before I came complimented me on a suit and tie on a hot day. And if anybody knows Don Newcomb, if you're going to pinch hit for Don Newcomb, I do not want it getting back to Don that his representative here was in an open collar and anything other than dressed up, because he's just an amazing person, but also the best dressed person whenever he's at the ballpark. Let's go back to 1946, because that's where this starts. And 3 African-American ballplayers report to the Brooklyn Dodgers to really play baseball, but they also made history just by showing up. And if you think about them in the context, 2 of them are now represented on United States postage stamps, Jackie Robinson and Roy Campanella. Now, Jackie passed away in 1972 at age 53. Roy Campanella passed away in 1993 at age 71. And now it's the year 2016, and Don is 90 years old, and Don is the one left to tell all the stories from way back then. And so as the Dodgers team historian, it's one thing to read something in a book, it's something to know the records and stuff that you read, but you really have to go to the primary sources, especially if you were brutal in Little League, and if you can't even make it in Little League, how are you going to judge these great players once they get to the ultimate level? And so Don, over the years, has always been a great source of stories and inspiration. And in 2005, it was the 50th anniversary of the 1955 Brooklyn Dodgers. And the Dodgers were going to invite the 13 surviving members back to Dodger Stadium. There was going to be a special reunion in Vero Beach. And
We also, because of the documentary, the same thing that you're doing in terms of wanting to have that oral history, we wanted to sit down with the former players and just let the camera roll and tell the stories. And so with Don, we talk about 1955, and you know, first off, you maybe talk about early in his career, the Rookie of the Year in 1949 and being a National League All-Star just 6 weeks into his career. You may talk about the years 1952, 1953, when in the prime of his career, he actually went into the military. And so as the Dodgers are winning back-to-back pennants, Nuke is in the Army. Nuke is serving his country. And so you see the lifetime statistics and wonder what might have happened with those 2 extra years. And then you look at 1954, Walter Alston takes over, and then 1955, it all comes together. They win 10 in a row to start the season, 22-2. In the World Series, they get off to a tough start, but then they come back. And it gets to be Game 7, and he tells the story so proudly. Johnny Padres, just get me one run. He says that on the bus going to Yankee Stadium October the 4th, and along with a great catch by Sandy Amoros in left field, put it all together, and there's a 2-0 Dodger victory, the first and only championship. So when you talk about all those things, there's so much excitement. Don would talk about in the clubhouse in 1955, a famous picture with Duke Snyder where they're both trying on each other's hats and they're pouring beer in each other's hats. And actually Don had gotten mad when they had clinched the pennant because they were really pouring it on and he was getting some of the really good clothes that he had stashed away wet. And so even though they were going to the World Series, it was like, hey, this is the good stuff. Don't mess with these clothes. So then they were having a laugh about it a week later when they finally beat the Yankees. But this is about 3 o'clock in the afternoon at the stadium, and the tape kept rolling. And so Don's all dressed up. What else would you like to talk about? Well, we kept going and kept going and kept going, but sometimes the tone changed, and Don kept going, and finally, there were some other subjects that Don talked about, freely volunteered, and so, okay, let's talk about what it was really like in 1946. About being in the minor leagues as far as the integration and having to start off at the low minors because some of the other minor league affiliates were not going to take African-American players. In fact, presidents of the league said, we'd rather not play than have integration. Then you keep going forward as far as what it was like in the clubhouse, what it was like in the locker room. And he was talking, finally he gets to be about 1954, and he's come back from the Army. And he's telling the story that he is just, he's looking around, and yes, Jackie made his debut, but this is 7 years after his debut, and there's been plenty of African-American ball players in the major leagues, and yet why, when you go to St. Louis, does the bus pull up, and a certain number of players have to get off the bus and take cabs to a different part of town, while the other players just go to the team hotel, even though it's not really a team hotel if they're not all there. So finally that really got to him. And he, along with Jackie Robinson, said, you know what, this is ridiculous. Let's go back to that hotel and let's just talk to the manager. This just isn't right. I was in the Army and everything like that. And he tells the story of talking to the manager. And the manager says he really doesn't have an answer. And he says, well, we don't want you using the pool. Well, Jackie says, that's fine, I don't swim. And Newcomb says, I don't swim during the season. So that problem is solved. But then the cameras keep rolling, and Don thinks about it. And he was thinking about all those times in between, 1947, 48. They're winning the pennant. They're very famous. 49, 50, 51, 52, 53. And he finally settles in on a hot day in St. Louis. And suddenly, this is all coming back to him. The Dodgers have played a game, and they go home that night, and they each go to the separate hotels, and Don has this picture of laying on a bed, and what he said they had to do was they took the sheet, and they went to the sink, and they wet it, and then they opened up all the windows because there was no air conditioning. And he's thinking about sitting on this bed. He's a major league player. He's with the Dodgers. He's supposedly a great star. Everybody wants his autograph at the ballpark, but at the end of the day, he's got to sit on this bed, hoping for a breeze to try to cool off. And he says, why? Couldn't somebody have said anything? And then he looks at the person interviewing him, who's me, and then it's a direct question. He said, couldn't anybody have done anything? And so suddenly, it's not a quote. This, in the middle of this dialogue, it's a conversation. Sometimes you're not expecting to hear these stories, and sometimes there are no answers. You may know all the stats, you may know all the pennant-winning years, and suddenly you're there and you don't have an answer for that. And later, part of that 1955 reunion, Don wasn't able to attend Vero Beach, but along with that was another poignant moment, because Clem Labine, the former relief pitcher, was at breakfast, and he was trying to explain to his family sort of the same thing about Jackie Robinson, but why this, why that, and he said, that's just the way it was back then. And then all of a sudden, he got very, very quiet, and he had a tear in his eye, and he looked down, and he said, I should have done more. I'm embarrassed. And right there, unprompted, he's at the breakfast table, he just starts to cry to himself, and he wasn't expecting it. It was just something, just like Don, thinking about that moment in the hotel room. Why? Why did this have to happen? And so I think that's very important. And for a organization like the Reliquary, I think not only Don accepting the award and being happy to be recognized, the Reliquary is really an opportunity to hear these other stories, not to hear the stats, not to hear the pennants and anything like that. It's all the things that happen in between. The stories about Glenn Burke, Charlie Finley, Bill Veeck, and who's ever got that wooden leg running around. But that's the wonderful part about, Terry, what you do with the Reliquary. Because in the beginning, Don wasn't quite sure what the Reliquary was. His wife was giving it to him. He says, it's where they put relics. To which Don said, thank you, dear. But when he found out more about the organization, he was really touched. And on behalf of Don, thank you for the award. Congratulations to all the other recipients. And thank you not only for this honor, but for hearing the Don Newcomb story. Thank you very much.
Those of you who attended last year's ceremony will recall that we inducted one of the iconic figures in Los Angeles baseball history, Steve Bilko, into the Shrine of the Eternals. One of the City of Angels' cultural treasures, folk singer Ross Altman, appeared on this stage and shared a song that he had written for the occasion honoring Steve Bilko, entitled Who's On First? In the lyrics to that song, Ross referred to Bilko as the Angelino Bambino and wrote in 1956, he won the Triple Crown. He's in the Baseball Reliquary's answer to Cooperstown, the Shrine of the Eternals, perfect place for an angel. I am very pleased to announce that Ross has just released his 13th CD and his first in 8 years, entitled The National Pastime, and it features studio recordings of 12 of his original baseball compositions, plus renditions of the Star-Spangled Banner and Take Me Out to the Ball Game. In addition to his song about Steve Bilko, there are other songs about Lou Gehrig, Babe Ruth, Pete Rose, Ted Williams, Roger Clemens, Phil Niekro, Jim Murray, Mickey Mantle, Jackie Robinson, Jimmy Pearsall, and the subject of civil rights and baseball. So today we congratulate Ross on the release of his new CD, and could you please stand, Ross? We believe that Ross's new CD will add immensely to the musical legacy of baseball. We are also pleased to note that we have copies of the CD available for sale today at the Reliquary table for $15. Our second inductee, Bo Jackson, was elected to the Shrine of the Eternals in his fourth year on the ballot. Bo is unable to attend today's festivities due to a previous commitment, but wishes to express his appreciation for his election to the membership of the Baseball Reliquary. Boas asked Steve Springer to both introduce and to accept the induction on his behalf. Steve Springer has been a sports writer for over four decades, during which time he has authored 13 books, three of which were bestsellers. American Son, written with boxer Oscar De La Hoya, was on the New York Times bestseller list. Two of his other books, Chick Hearn, his unpublished memoirs, and the memories of those who knew him, and My 30 Years in Dodger Blue with Fred Clare, were LA Times bestsellers. Springer spent 25 years as a sports writer for the LA Times, covering nearly every team in town. He has covered the Olympics, Super Bowls, the NBA playoffs, Stanley Cup finals, and the World Series. He has also done freelance pieces for the New York Times, ESPN.com, and USA Today. Steve is a member of the Southern California Jewish Sports Hall of Fame and a recipient of the prestigious Nat Fleischer Award, a lifetime achievement honor bestowed by the Boxing Writers Association of America. We are delighted to have him join us today to share his inside knowledge of Bo Jackson, having covered him during his playing career in Los Angeles. As we unveil Bo Jackson's induction plaque, please give a warm welcome to Steve Springer.
Pardon me while I put my glasses on so I can see what I wrote. It's a great honor to be here, Terry. I'd like to thank you and the Reliquary for inviting me. Congratulations to all the other award winners. And it's a special honor, really, to be on the same program with Arnold Hano. Growing up in the 1960s, if you were interested in sports, you had to read Sport Magazine. It was the Sports Illustrated of its time, and Arnold's stories always inspired me and showed me the possibilities of what writing could accomplish. So it's an honor to you, Arnold, and I'm happy to be on the same program with you. Some athletes are so elite that a one-word introduction is all that is required. Ali, Kobe, Babe, Kareem, Shaq, Pele, Wilt. As soon as I mention those names, I'm sure in your mind's eye you can see a towering home run, a backboard rattling dunk, a dramatic knockout. Now I'm going to utter two words, and for anybody in this room who is 30-something or older, they will trigger not one image, not one sport, but a highlight reel across the athletic spectrum. The words are Bo Knows. There was Vincent Edward Bo Jackson literally running up an outfield wall after making a catch, barreling his way through the Seattle Seahawks defense and down the sidelines on his way to the goal line, the end zone, and the tunnel leading to the locker room without so much as a pause, a 91-yard run for the ages on Monday Night Football. There was a Bo dressed for tennis, hoops, cycling, soccer, hockey, horse racing, auto racing, surfing, golf, and cricket. Bo Jackson was certainly not the first to suit up in more than one sport at the professional level. In the first half of the 20th century, Jim Thorpe played both Major League Baseball and pro football and was an Olympic gold-winning track and field star. Dave DeBuscher played in both the NBA and MLB. He was a forward for the Detroit Pistons and the New York Knicks and a pitcher for the Chicago White Sox. And there was Deion Sanders, who played Major League Baseball as an outfielder for four different teams over nine seasons, and in the NFL, where he played primarily at cornerback and on special teams for five clubs over 14 seasons. But Neon Deion couldn't match the brilliance of Bo, the shooting star who blazed across the sports landscape in spectacular fashion, but like all shooting stars, was extinguished all too quickly, a devastating hip injury ending his NFL career at age 28. Still, his spirit couldn't be broken. It was assumed his baseball career was also over after he was forced to undergo hip replacement surgery. But Bo, showing a level of resolve to match his talent level, came back to play two more years with an artificial hip. Though he won the Heisman Trophy in 1985, playing for Auburn, Bo's professional accomplishments were modest by normal standards. No World Series, no Super Bowl appearances. He never rushed for 1,000 yards nor scored more than 6 touchdowns in any of his 4 years with the Raiders. But because of the baseball season, he never played more than 11 games in an NFL season. In his 8 years in the big leagues, 5 with the Royals, 2 with the White Sox, and 1 with the Angels, Bo never hit more than 32 home runs or batted higher than 279. Only once did he drive in more than 100 runs. But again, he never played more than 135 games in a season. You know, I remember a conversation I had with my son, Alan, who's in the audience here, when he was 8, 9 years old, and always had his head in one of the media guides stacked on my desk. "Who was the greatest baseball player you ever saw?" my son once asked me. "Willie Mays," I said, without hesitation. "But he doesn't have any records," said my son said, being a kid. Other guys had more hits, more home runs, a higher batting average. "Willie Mays wasn't about numbers," I told him, though Mays certainly had monumental, if not record totals, in all the major categories. "You had to see Willie Mays play to understand what he was. There was no way I could explain him to you." So it was with Bo. Whatever he accomplished, whether on the diamond or the gridiron, he did with a combination of flair, explosiveness, and timing that enabled him to command the stage, whatever stage he was on, and leave fans with images that are still vivid a quarter century later. For example, Bo played in only one All-Star game, the 1989 Midsummer Classic at Anaheim Stadium. But leading off the bottom of the first, he smashed a towering 450-foot home run over the center field wall, Vin Scully describing the blast on the telecast by saying he almost hit it out of the state. And Bo went on to be named the game's MVP. Rick Sutcliffe, a member of the National League team in that game, said afterward of Bo's blow, "I will never, ever forget the sound of that baseball. That home run," said Sutcliffe, "was one of the many things that Bo Jackson blessed the game of baseball with." In 1990, Bo hit 3 home runs and 3 at-bats in a game at Yankee Stadium. He never got a shot at number 4 because he had to leave the game after dislocating his shoulder, diving for a ball hit by Deion Sanders. Bo missed 39 days, but in his first game back, in his first at-bat, he hit a 435-foot home run off Randy Johnson, who was then with the Seattle Mariners. Said Bo, "I still made that 4 consecutive home run club." Bo was getting over another shoulder injury when he caught a fly ball near the outfield wall in Baltimore's old Memorial Stadium one day in 1990. He was moving too fast to stop, but Bo was nevertheless determined to protect his tender shoulder from the wall looming ahead. So what did he do? Without breaking stride, he ran right up that wall, nearly to the top, and then back down again. "That seemed easier to me and logical," said Bo. "Maybe logical for Spider-Man, but not normal outfielders." Then there was the throw, capital T. It came in 1989, a 300 feet in the air throw by Bo to nail Harold Reynolds running from first base at the plate. "You need to pee in a cup," joked Reynolds. God gave me a built-in steroid," said Bo. "Baseball and football are very different games," Bo once explained. "In a way, both of them are easy. Football is easy if you're crazy as hell. Baseball is easy if you've got patience. They'd both be a little easier for me if I were a little more crazy and a little more patient." His ability to succeed at various athletic activities was amazing. "I taught myself how to pole vault in one day," he once said. "The next day, I entered a meet to pole vault and won it all for the state of Alabama." It was this phenomenal ability to excel at any sport he tried that inspired Nike to create the commercials that caused Bo's legend to grow even larger. Who could forget Bo Knows Tennis, Bo Knows Golf, Bo Knows Hockey, and on and on. But perhaps the biggest thing Bo knew was the importance of humility and acceptance. When he retired from baseball at the age of 31, he said, "God has his way of opening up our eyes to see reality. The way he opened my eyes is to allow me to have this hip injury. This is a rough way to go, but I had to accept the fact." He went on to get his college degree, as he had promised his mother before she died, went into business, worked with kids, and never complained. In an age when athletes often bemoan the cruel twists of fate that derail promising careers, here is a guy who had plenty to bemoan. A seemingly simple tackle in a Raider playoff game brought down one of the most powerful players to ever put on a uniform. He might have had another decade as a double superstar. Instead, he picked himself up quietly and moved on to enjoy the rest of his days. "Don't run too fast through life," he once said. "You only have one." Bo Jackson may be worthy of induction into a baseball or a football Hall of Fame, but he's also, based on his attitude and outlook and example, a Hall of Famer in the game of life. Thank you.
Earlier today, we mentioned that the Baseball Reliquary is featuring a display based on Michael Fallon's book, Dodgerland, in the north entrance cases of this library. That display is actually part of what we are calling a baseball four-bagger, which consists of four separate mini exhibitions spotlighting baseball history, culture, and art. Now, in the business wing, which is located at the east end of the library, we are featuring displays of baseball artworks by Greg Jasuski, who was introduced earlier, over there, and Pat Riott. I'm not sure if Pat made it today, I guess not. And they're in the business wing. And then in the humanities wing, which is also at the east end of the library, we have a display, wonderful display of memorabilia, which is on loan from the Michael Brown Negro Leagues collection at the Institute for Baseball Studies at Whittier College. And Joe Price is here today, a co-director of the Institute for Baseball Studies. Come over and visit us. We're there usually every Friday from 1 to 5 p.m. And you can check out our wonderful research materials there. Now, the exhibits are going to be on view today until 5 p.m., and also they will be on view through the end of this month, the closing on July 30th. So if you don't get a chance to take a look at them today, please come back before the 30th of July. Our third and final inductee, Arnold Hano, like Don Newcomb before him, was elected to the Shrine of the Eternals in his first year on the ballot. He will be introduced by one of our favorite reliquarians. Like Arnold Hano, Gene Ardell is a native New Yorker who now lives and writes in Laguna Beach. She first met Arnold at a baseball authors forum at Barnes & Noble in Costa Mesa, California. Gene is the author of the seminal book, Breaking Into Baseball, Women and the National Pastime, and is co-author of a book with left-handed pitcher and 2003 Shrine of the Eternals inductee Isla Borders. That book is entitled Making My Pitch, A Woman's Baseball Odyssey, and it will be published next spring by the University of Nebraska Press. A longtime fan of the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim, Jean holds many opinions about baseball, which is one reason why she likes spending time with Arnold and Bonnie Hano. To introduce the induction of Arnold Hano into the Shrine of the Eternals, class of 2016, please welcome to the lectern, Gene Ardell.
Thanks, Terry. This day just gets better and better every year. Thank you for all you do. You know, it's 20 to 4, and you told me I could go long. Do we shut down at 4?
No, 5.
Oh. No worries, we're not going to go to five. 90 years ago, this very season, a young mother taught her four-year-old son how to safely cross Edgemont Avenue in Upper Manhattan. Mind you, this was not considered child neglect in those days, for many young children had the run of New York City. The child's object in crossing Edgemont Avenue was to arrive at a popular venue just across the street, known as the Polo Grounds, where he would meet his grandfather, who would give him his pass to a seat above first base in the grandstand. The pass was one of the perks enjoyed by his grandfather, who was a lieutenant in the New York Police Department, and his grandson understood the highest ranking Jew in the police force in those days. And so it was that this boy would watch the New York Giants play baseball. In training her son to safely cross Edgemont Avenue, this mother unleashed upon the baseball universe an extraordinary fan and a writer of great talent. For that boy was, of course, Arnold Hano. One of Arnold's early acts of liberation came after he noticed that far more fun was to be had in the bleachers, where the language was much saltier than in the staid grandson's stand seats. And he moved his preferred location to that area of the ballpark, and to this day. He was soon able to finance his own independent excursions to the Polo Grounds by collecting pop bottles, which he stashed in the knickers that young boys wore in those days, and then redeeming the bottles for enough cash for a ticket to the bleachers, 50 cents. Arnold was enchanted by Bill Terry, the Giants' star first baseman. "I am left-handed, and Bill Terry was left-handed," he explains, "and he was my first hero." And so began his study of the athletes who played the game he fell in love with. With three teams in the city, New York in the late 1920s was a thrilling place for a young baseball fan. The Giants were in their glory years under their manager, John J. McGraw. Down in Brooklyn, the Dodgers were becoming the Giants' perennial nemesis, and nearby in the Bronx, the New York Yankees were beginning their ascendancy, led by Babe Ruth. Ensconced in the bleachers, Arnold soaked up baseball's rhythms, fundamentals, and stories, developing firm opinions on the game and its players. The greatest of them all, he claims, was Babe Ruth, because his talents went far beyond his famed home runs. He points out that Ruth broke fast, had an accurate arm, and always threw to the right base. And he stole 17 bases a season twice. Arnold was there when Ruth pitched for the New York Yankees on the last day of the 1933 season. Of Ruth's performance that afternoon, he says, quote, "He was cutting, he had finesse, he picked up the outside corner with his curveball. He went the whole nine innings, and the Yankees won 7-5, end quote. The guy can remember. Ruth's streak of 29 and two-thirds scoreless innings pitched in the World Series lasted until 1961, Hano goes on. So Ruth was a great pitcher, not just a good pitcher. One of the great pleasures of being a kid about Manhattan in those days was chance encounters with one of baseball's heroes. Just after Ruth had pitched that last game in 1933, Arnold spotted the great man on the street walking with his wife and daughter. "Hey, babe," Hano piped up, "how come you didn't strike anybody out the other day?" He recalls that Ruth laughed and said, "Oh, I wanted those palookas behind me to earn their keep." If New York City was rich in baseball, it was rich in stories, too. And Arnold's writing career started early. He was 7 or 8 when his elder brother, Alfie, recruited him to help with his self-published Montgomery Avenue News, which the boys sold door to door. Their primary source was the lurid accounts in the city's tabloids about the latest local gang assassination, which sometimes happened as a mob boss lingered at his favorite restaurant. To this day, Hano prefers a seat in any restaurant that faces the door with his back to the wall, a habit he shares with other New Yorkers. He continued writing as a student at Long Island University, working for the school newspaper as sports editor and co-editor. After graduating with a degree in English and journalism in 1941, he enlisted. I'm sorry, he didn't enlist yet. He worked for the New York Daily News until his enlistment in the Army. During World War II, both he and Alfie served with valor. Arnold, who attained the rank of second lieutenant, was awarded the Bronze Arrowhead, Arrowhead. And that means that he was in the first wave of people to go on shore of a particular fighting or particular zone of fighting. Alfie, however, did not make it through. His B-17 was hit by an enemy fire over Germany. After helping several enlisted men to safety, he went down with his plane. When the war ended, Arnold jumped into New York's literary milieu, teaching, editing, and publishing the fiction he wrote in his spare time. In 1951, he got lucky when he married Bonnie Abraham. The couple worked at the magazine management company. He is editor-in-chief of Lion Books. She is production manager for the young Stan Lee, who went on to Spider-Man comic fame. They were also politically active, going up to Harlem to help register black voters in the late 1940s. And wouldn't the Shrine's other inductee, Lester, one of the other inductees, Lester Rodney, delight in that? Heading west. In 1955, Bonnie and Arnold put their 18-month-old daughter, Laurel, and their beagle puppy into the back seat of their brand new Ford sedan and set out to find a new place to live. Bonnie had found New York City a difficult place to raise a child, and Arnold, who had left Lion Books to work write full-time, figured he could live and work anywhere. En route to on California Highway 1 to visit friends in San Diego, they passed through what Arnold calls, quote, a darling little town, an absolute charming town with some sophistication, end quote. To Bonnie, it felt like home. Inquiries were made. Was Laguna Beach expensive? No, said their friends. Too many starving artists. As a newly launched freelance writer, Arnold figured he'd fit right in. In Laguna, Arnold and Bonnie discovered a community that engaged their interest in the arts, their love for gardens and old homes, and their passion for grassroots politics. Early on, the Hanos discovered that the small African-American community in Laguna was not welcome in the city's three barbershops. Arnold quickly negotiated a change to that. In those days, he wrote during the mornings with afternoons devoted to ocean swims and body surfing, followed by martinis on the beach. The couple purchased a 1927 Hansel and Gretel style house in Bluebird Canyon. The home is on the city's historic register and they live there still. In 1971, Arnold served as the founding chair of Village Laguna. He was absolutely instrumental in establishing height limits along the beachfront. Bonnie currently serves as the corresponding secretary of the Village Laguna Board of Directors, also dedicated to preserving Laguna's charm. Since 2003, she has served on the Heritage Committee. Both Hanos are still regularly seen at city council meetings, which can go on past midnight. I love the oldest of Laguna, says Arnold, and that we managed to keep it Laguna. Well, much of the reason why Laguna Beach doesn't look like Miami Beach can be attributed to the Hanos' activism. Ask any longtime resident. Although California proved a good move for the Hanos, Arnold wasn't nearly as happy when the team he grew up with decided to move west. In the same way that people forswear love after a romantic heartbreak, Arnold swore off the Giants when they moved to San Francisco in 1958. It did not last, though. He reconsidered and follows the Giants unto today. And he continues to detest the Dodgers. A Dodger loss, he says, sometimes gives him greater pleasure than a Giant win. In California, Arnold was prolific, publishing baseball articles in such venues as we've heard as Sport Magazine, Western novels, short fiction in Ellery Queen and Alfred Hitchcock mystery magazines, biographies of heavyweight champion Muhammad Ali, basketball star Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and Willie Mays. One morning at breakfast in the early 1950s, he and Bonnie heard a radio report. Arnold recalls, quote, Senator Joe McCarthy had sent two of his stooges, Roy Kahn and David Shine, over to Europe to investigate U.S. Information Service libraries to see what kind of, quote, communist, end quote, propaganda they were peddling. And they found these, quote, communist, end quote, books by Hemingway and Steinbeck. And the news story said they had them burned. I went through the rest of the day feeling that something had been torn out of my stomach. Turned out that was not true. The books were not burned, but they were removed, end quote. The story prompted Arnold to write the short story, The Crate at Outpost One, about the dangers of not reading. For the crate of the title contains the enemy's greatest weapon, books. The story has been republished in more than 20 languages. To sum up, Arnold has published more than two dozen books and countless magazine articles. He worked as editor at Pacific Mutual Insurance and taught writing at the University of California at Irvine and USC. Along the way, he won such prestigious honors as Magazine Sports Writer of the Year in 1963. Another aspect of Arnold's influence on baseball writing became apparent last year. After he spoke at the 9 Spring Training Conference in Tempe, Arizona, Felipe Alou showed up to pay his respects. Alou remembered Arnold's advocacy for early Latino players, a man Alou termed our hero. Decades ago, after accepting profile assignments on Orlando Cepeda and Roberto Clemente, Arnold decided to acknowledge what he kept hearing about, the maltreatment of Latino players and misconceptions of their way of life by the members of the baseball establishment and by the media. I would speak up about that and become something of an apologist, he recalls. And when I'd go into the giant clubhouse to interview some Anglo player, Cepeda would come over, take my hand, and introduce me around to the Latino players, like Juan Marichal, saying, "This is Arnold Hano, he's our friend." Fan to fan, ask Arnold what brings us back to baseball, and he quotes a line from the novel Prospect by Bill Littlefield. "It is a sustaining game. Those five words, that's what holds us," he says. "I've been enthralled in baseball since I was 4, so you get hooked. The game has so many things that make it what it is. It's elegant, it's spread out the way soccer is, but it also has those rigid 90-foot base paths. And then the outfield goes crazy, it goes any old way. And the game combines the offense and the defense in one team. You don't then wait for the new 11 people to come on the field and take on the other guy's offense." So despite changes to the game, Arnold keeps coming back. With free agency and the movement of franchises and players and management in recent decades, he sees fans' loyalty fading, though not disappearing. If only to a logo, we are hooked to that team and it holds us, he says. You walk into a ballpark and the smell of hot dogs grabs you, the look of the green grass. He cites sports writer George Vesey's point that baseball is the only sport that calls its stadium a ballpark. A park, he emphasizes. Especially for city kids, baseball is a citified game. For a kid who has traveled like he did by subway or on foot to many a baseball game, you walk in and there's this expanse of green grass and rich brown dirt, and it's just a feeling of expansiveness. A lucky man. As a fan, Arnold considers himself blessed by what he calls momentary spasms of luck. He won a limerick contest in 1956 and was flown to New York for a World Series game. Don Larson pitched a perfect game. To celebrate their anniversary in 1962, he brought his long-suffering wife, Bonnie, whose heart does not beat to the rhythm of the game, to Dodger Stadium. Sandy Koufax pitched his first no-hitter. Perhaps his greatest luck, and ours, came on September 29th, 1954, when the Cleveland Indians met the New York Giants at the Polo Grounds for Game 1 of the World Series. Once settled in the left field bleachers, Arnold exchanged insults and observations with rival fans as he scribbled notes and reflections about the game next to his seatmates, the play on the field, and the game of baseball in the margins of his program and his folded New York Times. It was his great fortune then to be in prime position to witness center fielder Willie Mays' running catch of a Vic Wertz line drive, known ever after as the catch. After the Giants won the series, Arnold typed up his notes and showed them to a friend, wanting to know if they were any good. "Send it out," he was advised. And thus was launched Arnold's classic, A Day in the Bleachers, published in 1955. Arnold still has much to say about his sustaining game. He does not approve of the wild card, the uneven distribution of teams in both leagues' divisions, or the American League's DH rule. I am so bored out of my skull by the emphasis on the home run and by the fact that we've brought the fences in, we've lowered the mound, we've shrunk the strike zone, now it's the size of an umpire's heart. At which point, I'm surprised you're not jumping up to demonstrate this, Arnold. He likes to demonstrate an acceptable strike zone. We've juiced up the ball, we've juiced up the bat, and we juiced up the players. I think the game's out of the balance as a result. It's pitching that intrigues him, he said, and I would sometime like to write about that, emphasizing the role of the wonderful rivalry of pitcher versus batter. Another story remains to be told, too. Sometimes when Arnold can't sleep at night, he thinks about more writing to be done. One of the things I've thought of is a short memoir, How Am I Doing, Big Brother? Because Alfie was killed when he was 25 years old, and he was my big brother. And I've always felt that he was sort of looking over my shoulder, checking me out as I go along, giving me grades and things like that. When I thought of the title, it sort of gave me the focus that I needed. 61 years after publication, A Day in the Bleachers is still in print. Arnold is still in play, too. As a recent panelist at the LA Times Festival of Books, a speaker at the 9 Spring Training Conference, and as the subject of John Leonard Dacus's wonderful documentary, Hano, A Century in the Bleachers. He is currently nearing completion of a play that will be considered by the Laguna Moulton Playhouse. The play is entitled A Rather Odd Couple, and it involves Harry S. Truman and Monica Lewinsky. Arnold, it's a pleasure to welcome you to the Shrine of the Eternals induction ceremony of 2016. How fitting that it comes a neat 90 years after you first crossed Edgemont Avenue.
There's nothing left to say.
Sorry.
And thank you, Jean. Thank you, Terry. And thank you guys for coming and for voting for me. I am the afterthought. We had Don Newcomb and Bo Jackson. And then finally, with 26% of the vote, which means 74% of the people did not vote for me. There I was, finally. Anyway, it's lovely, it's charming to be here. The life of a writer cannot be condensed into these few minutes, so let me just talk about a couple of little things that strike my mind. Some of it I picked up during today, and sometimes I just think about it at night when I can't sleep, which is often. The saddest thing that I can think of is that I understand there's now a machine. They can place it behind the catcher, and that will call balls and strikes. Right, thank you for and that's how I feel also. It isn't that I love umpires. I love and hate umpires. But the umpire is the final arbiter, and to have his decision now determined by somebody in a cave in New York City to determine whether he did touch or did not touch the base is absolutely ludicrous. Besides which, thank you. You can quote me. It's also time-consuming. All this talk about let's speed up the game. There have been some funny remarks about speeding up the game. When Vin Scully was asked what made the game so slow, he thought for a moment and he said, batting gloves. and if you remember, I forget his name, but that one batter that would go, who was that? Well, whoever it was. After each pitch, after he would step out and he would go through each finger of each hand of the glove and then step back in. I think the thing that's making the game so slow is the bullpen. There used to be a pitcher who would go 7-8 innings, and then somebody would step in and help that eighth inning, and then maybe the ninth inning. But now we have these experts. I watched that Giant game, San Diego game yesterday. Very sad. In the eighth inning, the Giants used Sergio Romo, who had to face Will Meyer, who was hit 20 home runs, and then Kemp, and then Losado. Anyway, whoever it was, and he struck out the first two and got the other guy on a ground ball to first base. He probably used 12 pitchers, 13 pitchers. So why not pitch him in the ninth inning also? They had all that break at that ridiculous All-Star game. They had all that breaking time, so he could have pitched another inning. Instead, they brought in that lame guy who can't get anybody out anymore. And not only does he give up 4 hits in a row, then he makes a balk and balks in the winning run for the San Diego team. And I'm a Giant fan. Sad. Fandom is great fun. Fandom is the glue that keeps all of us together. I remember sitting out with my father and my brother and my mother's father, my grandfather. We sat in a row at the Polo Grounds one day, and I sat next to Ike. We called my grandfather Ike. Everybody did. And I said, Ike, I said, tell me about Honus Wagner. My grandfather was of German descent, and his favorite team was Pittsburgh because of Honus Wagner being of German descent. And he said, Honus Wagner had hands large as pillows. And I thought, wow, that does it. I now know how big his hands were, and I know also how soft his hands were. And so I know that Honus Wagner must have been a very great shortstop, just in that one little sentence. So fandom, in my case, was familial. My grandfather, my father, and my brother and I were all fans, and we went and we bled and we died and we cried, and it's the what should be. The Giants have been my team. I don't know why Gene said I lost faith in them when they came out. I came out in 55. They followed me. And when the Dodgers went to Chavez Ravine, I also wondered what happened to all those uprooted Mexican-American families there that got kicked out. So it was easy to hate the Dodgers. It's been easy to hate the Dodgers ever since, despite Don Newcomb. And Don Newcomb, a great pitcher that he was, you have to remember that all of our great ball players had moments when they weren't so great. Don started the 51 playoff game where Bobby Thompson hit the home run. He started that game. He didn't throw that ball that Ralph Banker threw, of course. And he started the playoff game in 62 when the Giants beat the Dodgers, when the Dodgers completely collapsed in the ninth inning. And Dick Young wrote his wonderful lead. I'm not good at memorizing things, so this I'm paraphrasing. Dick Young wrote of the Dodgers, he said, the tree that grows in Brooklyn is an apple tree, and one of its products is stuck in the throat of the Brooklyn Dodgers. Which is his way of saying they choked, and they did. Little things like that. You've had Hilda Chester and great fans. We had in the Polo Grounds a guy named Louis Capel, K-O-P-P-E-L, kind of a little fat guy, sat there in the bleachers off slightly to the right, further into the left field side. As a result, I'm sitting in the bleachers and the ball game's out there, and he was sitting out here. And he was there when Joe Adcock hit his home run into the center field bleachers at the Polo Grounds. It landed in Louis Capel's lap. Then it rolled to the floor below, between his feet, and he said to me, I was so fat, I couldn't pick it up. And some kid ran over and picked up, that kid has my baseball, he said. Louis liked to think that he inspired Bobby Thompson. He spoke kind of Buddhist language to him to tell him to have faith and relax and do this and do that. And then Bobby Thompson hit that home run, which may have been because the Giants may have had a camera in the clubhouse telling him when there was a fastball coming up and when it wasn't. It's been a great and fun-filled life, and I admire that all of you continue that going. I wish I saw better. I wish I could see the games instead of having to take a chair and move it closer to the 48-foot screen we have. But I still call balls and strikes, and I know when I'm right and the umpires are wrong. I've been on the road recently with John's film about me, which is titled correctly Hano, a Century in the Bleachers. Even though when my paragraph about me appeared to vote for this thing, the person who wrote it said Hano, a Life in the Bleachers, which is not correct. It was Hano, a Century in the Bleachers. But then somebody today called me author from up here. Wow. So anyway, I've been on the road, and at the very first screening of Hano, a Century in the Bleachers, I made some disparaging remarks about the quality of last year's, the year before that World Series, the Kansas City A's and the Mets, Kansas City Royals and the Mets. And how the first baseman seemed to be content in trying to see who could give the game back to the other team. When I said, you know, that's a pity, that was not a particularly well-played game. And somebody in the seats during the question period, I think he took umbrage. And he said, because I had been talking about Babe Ruth, he said, do you think Ruth could hit 340 today? So I thought, I should have said, didn't say, well, he would have been 130 years old. maybe 311, 312. But I didn't see that. These snappy comebacks don't come so snappily when you're 94 years old. But I do think back at that moment, and I think that Babe Ruth in his prime would have hit the 340 that I thought. He adapted so well. He was beautiful. People see him today and think of him only as that fat slob. And even some ball players thought that way. I sat at a bar in Scottsdale next to Carl Hubbell 30 years ago or so. And we were talking about different things, and we talked about Ruth and how he really, at the end of the career, you know, he looked pretty shot. And Hubbell said, yes, in 1935, when he was playing with the Braves, the Giants had opened the series in Boston. And he said, I pitched, he said, and I saw this fat slob get up. You could smell the beer from the plate to where I was. I thought, oh, poor old guy. I'll just throw him fastballs. I'm not going to throw him a screwball. And I hear stories like that. So I said, how far did he hit it? and he said, he hit it to Tulsa. true to Hubbell's, you know, background. Anyway, it's lovely when people do things like that. And it's made my life a pleasure. I don't particularly care about dying, but I certainly would much prefer the opposite. And so I thank you again. I thank you for your attention. I thank you for your laughter. You laughed at all the right places. And I hope you have hope you drive carefully. Thanks a mil.
Bonnie says I did good, I did good.
Just a few final remarks before we conclude today's ceremony. The Baseball Reliquary has several outstanding exhibitions and programs planned between now and the end of the year. To keep informed of our programming, please bookmark the Baseball Reliquary's website, baseballreliquary.org, and you can check the upcoming events page from time to time. We also have very lively Facebook pages for both the Reliquary and the Institute for Baseball Studies. So if you have an interest in social media, please join both of those pages and take part in our ongoing presentation and discussion of all things baseball. Last but not least, we make our most important pitch of the afternoon. If you are not already a member of the Baseball Reliquary, please consider purchasing a membership today. The basic annual membership is a modest $25 a year, and it includes full voting privileges for next year's Shrine of the Eternals election. Join with us as this organization continues to make its mark on the cultural and baseball landscape of the United States. Or as Don Malcolm wrote the other day for the Hardball Times website, as the Reliquary continues to reinvent how to view the history of the game. Malcolm concluded his essay by saying, "Let's give thanks for the miraculous, full-blown adulthood of the Baseball Reliquary, agelessly wise beyond its years, and still brimming with the snap, go, fling of a timeless game that bonds us with our vibrant, fleeting youth." Please enjoy the refreshments which we have available in the back of the room and the good fellowship that is an integral part of the Shrine of the Eternals festivities. And until next year, we bid you a fond farewell.